Good evening and good morning wherever you are in the art world. The Art Talks are delighted tonight to welcome all of you for another fascinating art talk. So tonight we're going to speak about art and science. So study the science of art, study the art of science, develop your senses, learn how to see. Realize that everything connects to everything else, Leonardo da Vinci. So tonight we're going to discover or rediscover how art and science are connected. So we are welcoming our speakers, which are a bit all around the world tonight. And we are going to have Radoslav Mehandzhiyski, curator and founder of Art and Culture Today. And then we are going to have our wonderful curator of today's panelist. It's Anna Anchimiuk, molecular biologist and Figure 118 member. Then Silvia Brochet, scientist and microbiologist. Eli Joteva, Bulgarian intermedia artist and researcher based in Lei. And Giuseppe Lo Schiavo from Milano. Artist again, and also interested in AI. Welcome all. How are you? So I will start with Radoslav. Radoslav, you have you are a curator and the founder of Art and Culture Today, and Mihako. Could you tell us a bit how it all started, a bit what is the story behind your wonderful projects, and a bit to give us an historical background?
Yes, of course. Well, Art and Culture Today, it's an independent platform for contemporary art, which is dedicated to popularizing contemporary art among wider non-professional audience. So we are basically trying to speak about this art in a very down-to-earth language, and we try to engage in a meaningful way new people, so that there is a meaningful conversation and that there's higher social value to this art. Doing this, I can say many things about the organization, but I'll just share that by doing this, we've seen that there is an amazing potential for communication, and actually we are developing new tactics for communication here in Bulgaria. I think we are in a way lucky to be in a slightly underdeveloped market, let's say, and environment for contemporary art, because this is the perfect exploration setting, you know, where you can try out different models and patterns of communication. And this is very much related to our organization. We curate, of course, a lot of exhibitions. We have international artist residency here in Bulgaria, which is visited by artists from all over the world. And in a nutshell, let's say that this is the most important. And now I'll share my screen so that we get into the topic. Let me just see if everything will go as planned. Everybody sees it, yeah?
Yes.
Okay, perfect. So, yes, the topic of art and science, it is very wide. It is absolutely fascinating. So I wouldn't even consider exhausting it in 10 or 12 minutes. Actually, for this talk, I decided to share a little bit of popular historical context. I'll mix that with a few examples from the contemporary art world, and then I'll leave the floor, of course, to the fascinating artists and scientists who are here with us today. So, I'll just start by saying that in the modern history of Europe, the concept of the scientist, the way we understand it today, and the term scientist, they occur somewhere in the mid-18th century. And before that, the separation between artists, scientists, and other curious souls was not so clearly defined. Actually, you had the term natural philosophers being used, which means that in essence, you had people who were exploring nature, natural phenomena, and reality as a whole, and they had different means of representing their findings. In some cases, that could be a scientific observation. In others, it could be a painting. And of course, the classical example of somebody who simultaneously embodies the scientist, the artist, but also the botanist, the engineer, it was Leonardo da Vinci, you started with his quote. A curious fact is that it is widely believed that to be able to draw these drawings in particular, he would hire grave diggers, and other people would do that as well, to dig out dead bodies and bring these dead bodies to him so that he's able to literally see what's inside. And you know, this kind of curiosity was very dangerous at the time because it was considered strictly illegal by the church. Another curious example is Santiago Ramón y Cajal. In the 19th century, he was a neurologist and pathologist. He studied the brain tissue and cells of the nervous system through a microscope. And he came out with this amazing drawing. Of course, you know, his scientific findings were very important and he won a Nobel Prize for this. But these drawings and these paintings, because of their inherent artistic presence, are very often seen not only in textbooks but also in art galleries, and I genuinely believe that they feel very comfortable there. Another example of this nature is Maria Merian, who was fascinated by insects and plants, and she made these super pedantic, very careful drawings. And at the same time, by doing so, she was trying to understand the process of metamorphosis. She was fascinated by this process. And I'm sharing these examples because the common thing which is related to this very early scientific exploration is that art represents what is seen so that it could be better understood. You know, the very act of painting was also a process of understanding. And these illustrations later become the most important reference point for scholars to create some kind of classifications of the natural world. So these are very, very important from historical point of view. But if we have to approach the topic from a different perspective, we have the example, let's say, of Leonardo of Pisa, known as Fibonacci. His famous Fibonacci sequence is usually represented with this perfect spiral, and it's present in a lot of paintings in the art history, but also musical compositions and so forth. But the funny thing is that he had no intention whatsoever to have his findings related to art. He had a completely different goal, and his goal was actually to solve a puzzle about the perfect rabbit population. So he was basically interested in how rabbits would mate in a way so that they create the optimal population for the future. What would be the perfect pattern? And that's where the numbers come from, which is like a funny fact, I guess. A curious example is that of Charles Minard, because he is a mathematician, but he has very significant contribution to the field of information graphic and statistics. And he creates the so-called flow maps. Basically, these are visual representations of events incorporating a series of criteria. In this particular case, with the Napoleon March against Russia in 1812, there are six types of data incorporated in this image, and that's the number of Napoleon's troops, distance, temperature, the latitude and the longitude, direction of travel, and the location relative to specific dates. And it's very curious to see the final result from a purely visual point of view, because right now the whole topic of data representation is a very big thing in contemporary art. And we can even speculate that artists like Ryoji Ikeda are following this visual tradition through his abstract data and information inspired video installation, but there's also all kinds of projects which are trying to use data and compose it and synthesize it into certain artistic expression. And yes, it is actually a very, very curious subfield, subdimension of contemporary art in general. So, you know, we are at the stage where we already know a lot of things, both in science and in art. Right now, it's not only about observation, but it's also about relationships between the known elements, and contemporary art is very rich in this respect. Sometimes the focus is on purely aesthetical aspects of reality, But sometimes these collaborations between art and science, they dig into really fundamental issues related to all kinds of things, ecology, matter, life sustainability, and so forth. So I decided to pick up two examples almost on a random basis. The first one is Heather Dewey Hagborg. She is exhibiting these 3D printed faces, but the backstory of these faces is quite curious because she's actually collecting hair or cigarette leftovers from the streets and the subways of people that she doesn't know. And then she's extracting the DNA from the hair, for example, and using a software and the 3D printer, she's suggesting what would be the actual person look like, what would be he would be looking like, what would be his face image. And she's doing that because she wants to pay attention to a bigger topic, which is related to biological surveillance. So she's basically speculating that in the not so far future, we might have situations where our DNA is collected without our knowledge, and legal and illegal organizations are even blackmailing us because they know something about us that we don't even realize. So we don't know. Hopefully we don't experience exactly that type of situation. Another very famous example is Neri Oxman. She's talking a lot about augmented biology and evolution by design. She's both scientist and an artist, and she's also very much interested in finding new materials which are sustainable. And in this case, with the chitin, which is the second most abundant biopolymer in nature, she decided to collect it, to extract it. I think there is some chemical intervention there, but the final result are these sculptures, these art objects, which are trying to manifest the idea that you know, this new material that she's using is actually strong enough, it is elastic enough, it is flexible enough, and it could even potentially substitute part of our plastic manufacturing for utilitarian purposes, because if you throw these objects in the sea, for example, they wouldn't pollute it, but they would enrich the sea life with the natural characteristics that this material possesses. So this could be actually a very, very important in terms of applications. Another project of hers is related to combining in a laboratory setting bacteria which would never meet in the natural world. In this case, we are talking about cyanobacteria and E. coli. The first one is found in water ponds and the second one in the human gut. The first one is turning light into sugar, and then the second one is turning sugar into biofilm. And she's again speculating that this biofilm could be used for these very extravagant clothing, which is actually very, very sensitive to our body and our skin. So she's imagining that in a situation where we are already experiencing interplanetary voyages, our body might be experiencing something extreme, and then this matter, this new clothing, will be able to sense these needs and to you know, feed them with whatever it is being needed. And that is why she's talking about an evolution by design and not by natural selection, because she's literally putting these bacteria in the lab and she's designing something new, which again, as I said, would never happen naturally because these two would never meet in reality. So, you know, the importance of this huge collaboration and the huge potential of this collaboration between art and science, it is being recognized. And that is why there are more organizations and institutions who are supporting this type of endeavors. You have this great collaboration between New York artists and scientists at the Bell Telephone Laboratories taking place. The Leonardo Journal is entirely dedicated to these topics that we will discuss today. You've got the CERN initiative, which is basically something like an artist residency. Artists are going to CERN, they're spending some time there so that they learn about the very nature and structure of the universe, and then they create their own project. On the other side, you have art institutions and organizations who are welcoming scientists in residency positions, like the Institute of Contemporary Art in London, and we have Princeton University Art of Science initiatives, among many others. And in this context, I'm very glad to share that we, with our organization Art and Culture Today, together with Figure 1A, the leading partner, and Little Bird Place Gallery in Sofia, the three organizations, we are also part of this big topic and this big family with a concrete project, which we call the Scientific Art Lab. And within this project, we united the efforts of five artists and five scientists paired in five duos. And each duo will have a relatively long period of time to create an artwork or a series of artworks, which then will be exhibited in traveling exhibitions. We are at the early stages of the realization of the project. Right now, we are securing our funding. And if everything goes by plan, at the end of 2023, we should have at least two exhibitions, one in Bulgaria and one in Switzerland. And if we are able to secure the full funding, then you will all be able to see in more details the inner process of the project, because there will be a documentary movie following the themes. And again, this is a super exciting project, which requires a lot of logistical administration, but I think everybody understands how cool and how important it could be, and we really hope that we'll be able to realize it in its full potential. So this was basically it, the presentation that I prepared. Hopefully I managed to do it within the 10 minutes that we discussed. And again, compliments for choosing this topic, because it's really amazing. I'm sure that the most curious details are going to be shared in minutes through the other participants in the event. So thank you once again.
Thank you, Radoslav. I think it is quite fascinating for all of us. You know, it's the importance of art and science is being recognized, as you said, well said, worldwide. And I think you are doing an amazing work to, you know, to have a voice about, you know, about your project. As Silvia Brochet said, well said, scientific research needs, though, to be understood by the broad public to fulfill its purpose. So this is why Anna Anchimiuk will explain a little bit better what is the Figure 1A, this annual, amazing annual scientific art exhibition, which is inviting scientists and artists worldwide to work together. Molecular biologist, you know, yeah. It's already for me, it's amazing, fascinating, and that tries to find the sweet spot in between science, art, and sport. But you are, you know, with your PhD, you were focusing on how the DNA maintains its 3D structure inside the bacterial cells. And then you found your way in Figure 1A in December 2019.
Yes,
so, exactly. What inspired you to be part of this wonderful group?
Yes. So, well, I at the be- so the Figure 1A it was founded in 2017, and then I was participating in it as a viewer, and I really enjoyed it. And I was I was working at the same department as the founder, Vanetta, at the time, and once we just were talking, and in the end, I got involved in the project, which I think it's very, I find it very eye-opening on one side, because if you stay all day in the lab and you do your work, it's a nice change to do something completely, maybe not completely different, but something that requires different set of skills and a different mindset also. So I find it very interesting. Well, Radoslav already gave a very nice introduction and outlined the connection between art and science. But I just wanted to begin with this image here, which comes from a scientific publication from Neurobiology from 2007. And it shows, it depicts the result of eye movement tracking for people who are trained in art or are not trained in art. And on the left, you can see that the people, this is from the people that are not trained in art, and you can see how focalized their eyes are on the very specific parts of the images. Whereas for artists or people who are engaged in arts for several years, they seem to scan the image much more broadly. And I think I was very fascinated when I first saw this image. So as you also mentioned in the description of the event on LinkedIn and Radoslav also a few minutes ago, it seems that art and science, that they were one, but at some point they started drifting away, probably because of all this knowledge accumulation over the years. And I believe that they are a bit coming together and then separating a bit more, but in the end they are trying, both art and science, they are trying to answer the same questions of what is true, why does it matter, and they just have different toolboxes to answer those questions. And on top of that, we are all part of a society, so we have kind of a mission and an obligation to communicate whatever are our findings. And I think that figure 1A is falling exactly at the intersection of those three areas. And I would first like to introduce you to the team. We are a non-profit organization based in Lausanne in Switzerland. As for this week, we are not 12 but 13 people in the team. You can see Vanetta, the founder, in the top right corner. And we are all scientists and or artists that are full of energy, full of ideas, and we are every year very happy to prepare a new exhibition. So this slide here is a bit crowded, but I just wanted to indicate how much we grew from the year that we were founded in 2017, where the exhibition was only 3 days long, and the submissions were from a single department at the University of Lausanne, until now, where last year we had worldwide open submissions for the second time. We reached many renowned institutions, scientific institutions. We had two big exhibitions and also one first international exhibition in Sofia in Bulgaria that was curated by Radoslav, actually. And so what is important for us and our organization is, first of all, that the mission is to create conditions for open-minded communication between the public and the sciences. And to do that, we want to remove as many obstacles as possible. One of them is to bring the exhibition as close to the public as possible. So we take it away from the university campuses and we put it in central locations in the city. And for example, here are some images from our previous exhibitions. They are always in the very center of the city. And this is from last year, where we were at the City Hall of Lausanne in the main square. And we also last year had a bit logistically challenging location in Pontus in Salperier, where we also chose it because of the COVID situation to have more space to accommodate as many people as possible. Another important point for figure 1A is to actively engage the audience. And in order to do that, we organized workshops like here, the microscopy workshop, where the kids could bring some specimens that we would help them to visualize them using light microscopy. Or, for example, last year, we also had an abstract photography workshop. And one evening we had a meeting with three invited speakers, one of them being Giuseppe, who is also in the call today, about developing a career somewhere between art and science. Another important differentiation point of figure 1A is its scientific interdisciplinarity and mixed media that are used within the exhibition. So we not only show images, we also have videos, we have paintings, drawings, and on top of that, the spectrum of topics goes from microbiology through chemistry, mathematics, modeling, or even psychology. So here you have a few examples of the images. These are mostly from the exhibition from last year. This is a strain of Streptomyces, which is an actinobacterium that produces several antibiotics. And then you can see a submission from a field of mathematics that shows two fluids like oil and vinegar, and that how in this process of them two mixing together can be mathematically described and simulated. After that, we also have an example from plant biology, where the seed that is genetically modified becomes fluorescent in the process. And apart from the exhibition, Figure 1A is also partnering with other events, like for example, last year we were invited by the Centre Artistique Culturel in Sion. Some of our images were presented there, and also some of our speakers were invited to give a background. And one of them is Silvia, is today in the call, and I guess she'll be the most competent person to tell you a bit more about what's behind the work that she's creating. This Radoslav already mentioned. We are now developing a very exciting project to put together 5 artists and 5 scientists to work jointly on a common topic. And yeah, Ellie is also involved in that. She will speak later today. And I have also another small announcement that actually tomorrow we are opening submissions for the next round of Figure 1A exhibition. And this year it's open worldwide, like it was for the last 2 years, but the new thing is that it's not only scientists that can apply, but also there is a category prepared for artists who use scientific methodology in their work. So please check out their website if you are interested in participating. The submissions open tomorrow, they will be open until the end of the month. And if you have any questions or you need any additional information, this is all available on our website. We are present on social media, on the LinkedIn also. So yeah, feel free to get in touch. If you have any additional questions, we will be very happy to answer. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Anna. And obviously, you can all meet through the Art Talks platform, so that you gave us a wonderful idea to put just a topic on scientific art exhibition. So that would be fantastic. Thank you, Anna. Actually, that's a wonderful insight. And I adore every picture you showed us. It's like a work of art itself. Yeah. So I will start with Silvia. Thank you, Anna. And then we will come back in case anybody would like to have any questions later on. Silvia, as I said, I introduced Anna with your quote, because I love how you present yourself as a PhD, microbiologist and a scientific communication wizard. I love it. So, you also, your PhD was on the honeybee gut microbiota to carry out research about microbial communities. And in the meantime, you were also an amazing artist, and you were finalist in Figure in 2021. Make it a bit cool.
Yeah.
More cool.
Yeah, but thank you for the introduction, and hello everyone. Yes, so I'm Silvia, and I just completed a PhD in microbiology here in the University of Lausanne. But my PhD was not exclusively science, because it took a very nice artistic twist. And this was thanks to the fact that I came to know this beautiful organization and exhibition event that Tania was telling you about, so Figure 1A. And actually, when I was invited to speak today, I started to think what to say. I started to think about why I started to be interested in Figure 1A and to submit my artwork. And basically, I had to go back a few years because it was 5 years ago that I went for the first time to attend to an exhibition organized by Figure 1A. And I remember that I was really impressed because it was the first time that I could really see artwork related with science so much. And before I was rather used to these rare moments of beauty when I was alone in the lab. So this really inspired me a lot, and I was thinking if it can inspire me so much that I'm a scientist, I wonder what impact can have on non-scientist people, right? And this is actually something that is super valuable to me, and you already started to talk about it, because I think that when we keep science to our bench or to our lab, we are actually making it reductive, and we take out meaning from science. So basically, I looked at Figure 1A and this thing of using art to show science as a beautiful way to show science to the broad public. Because you must know that with Figure 1A, we don't only expose these images and leave them to the imagination, but we also add some scientific descriptions. And now I will show you, I will share my screen and show you an example from one picture, actually the first one that I submitted and was chosen to be exposed. So basically, this was the first picture that I was fortunate enough to get into the exhibition. And basically, here, this picture, I called it Metabolic Explosion. So, and then to this image, I add a description of the biological process that is found behind. So basically, you can see here a sequence of three images that I took with a microscope over time. And you can see this kind of explosive structure forming. So this is a phenomenon that is triggered by bacterial metabolism. So basically, there is a compound that bacteria can actually degrade or digest. And when this happens, there is this beautiful ramification structures that are formed. So you can imagine that without bacteria, we would not see anything in this picture. And this is what I wrote in the description of this image. And I was quite amazed by thinking that this way I could talk about bacterial metabolism to maybe a non-scientist that never thought about bacterial metabolism in its life, which is perfectly fine. but it was great to have this chance, because I think that in this way we can include people into the scientific process and into the scientific discussion, and to make them understand that science is actually not something that it's not easy to grasp or that is not for everyone. So I think that science is really something that can be made accessible to everyone. We just need to find the right means, and this is one of them. And in this way, we can actually avoid people to develop rather suspicion or refusal or mistrust in the regards of science, which can actually be quite dangerous. And but then I realized that it was not only useful for non-scientists, but also using art was super useful for scientists as well. Because something that we can do with this project is that we can submit and use images that actually we obtain from failure, so from failed experiments. And I started to think, and actually 3 out of 4 of the work that I submitted to Figure 1A are the result of a failed experiment. So a failed experiment is when, for example, we as microbiologists, we have to work with a certain organism, it can be a fungi or a bacterium, and suddenly, so we need a pure culture, we say a pure situation where we have only that organism to investigate about its function and to characterize it. So we have a contamination. It means that another organism comes in and we need to trash the experiment. This is something that happened, for example, here. You can see in this image that I submitted, this is my hand. I'm holding a, what we call a culture plate. And basically here, the idea of my experiment was to use the fungi that you see, the structure that dominates over the plate. It's a fungi that spreads with this circle over the plate. But unfortunately, or fortunately, as you want to see, there was another fungi that you can see the structure on the bottom that contaminated my plate and started to kill my fungi. So the experiment was failed, but I thought that this was beautiful. And I submitted this work and it was also chosen for the exhibition. And something similar happened to also my next work. This is a bacterial explorers, I call them. Basically here, I also had a contamination, this time from bacteria on my plates. And I found that this was beautiful because you can read this image from the center to then the edges. You can see that basically there are these structures forming and ramificating again. And these are actually bacteria that spread on this plate, on this culture plate, and occupy it all and are probably also accumulating mutations. So they are basically evolving as they spread on this plate. So I think that this is really fascinating, and not only failure, but also the process of that we use to get to represent our data can be inspiring, but we never get the chance to show it. But I got the chance to show it and to submit this picture that I'm showing now to Figure 1A that actually was selected last year for the jury prize. And basically this is a plot that will never be present in one of my publications because it's actually not not enough detail or right. But I just thought that it was beautiful and it was a plot that I obtained in, when I was trying to represent my, my data in a graphical way. So I call this plot long playing interactions because it looks like a vine. But actually what it is a graphical representation of an experiment when I was trying to study interactions between pairs of bacteria. So here, every semicircle tells me something about the strength of the interactions between the bacteria, but also of the type of the interaction. So basically, I can know from the position of the semicircles on the plane if the bacteria are actually helping one another, so interacting positively, or harming one another, interacting negatively. But as I was saying, this you will never see in one of my publications because despite we are very transparent as scientists, we actually never publish either progress or failure and negative results. And this can actually have a strong impact on us scientists and I guess also outside, because it can give us the wrong impression that failure doesn't happen or is not existing in science. But I think that is actually the reverse, that failure is something, a process that is intrinsic to science and sometimes is needed, because thanks to failure, you can actually reformulate your hypothesis, also make better your experimental design, and then try again and hopefully get to a result. So I think this is super important. And another thing that using art can help a lot, I think, scientists, is to take a step back and to look at our questions and our hypothesis from another perspective. So we often get stuck into these problems, into this failure, into this analysis. And I think that taking a step back and looking at it from another perspective can be super insightful. And also all of this discussion that can be generated between non-scientists and scientists by using these artworks. So yeah, basically these are two of the main things that I learned during this year. So the importance of using art for broadening the scientific results and discussion to make it accessible to the public, but also to broaden our perspective towards our research, so as scientists. And I think that we can also give something back to art, not only take, because we can give art a new canvas and we can give them beautiful images. And I hope you enjoyed the one that I showed you, and I'm available to take any questions if you have some later.
Again, I would like to start paraphrasing one of your quotes, saying about artists and scientists is indeed a bidirectional, fruitful collaboration. So art is great at visualizing scientific research, but it can also push the limitation of science into the realm of imagination. So welcome, Eli.
Thank you. Thank you so much for having me.
A bit more.
Well, hello. Thank you for having me. My name is Eli Joteva. I was born in Bulgaria, based in LA. My background is in fine arts. Just a little bit of intro. I did my bachelor's in fine arts and my MFA in digital media. And I tend to draw a lot of inspiration from the mystery of the invisible. In a lot of my work with science, I try to kind of extract the invisible forces that and patterns and vibrations that might exist outside of our perception, but still influence us. So this is why I tend to use imaging tools like MRI or LiDAR or EEG sensors or satellite data, and work with scientists from different fields in order to push beyond our perspectives and limited human perceptions. So in the next 10 minutes, I'm going to show you some science-inspired projects, as much as I could fit in the 10 minutes. So the first one, I guess I want to just say that my artistic approach, much like the scientific one, always starts with a question. This project started with the question of, can I make an image using invisible light? And this question led me through a series of experimental processes that culminated in using two technologies from two different eras and two ends of the invisible light spectrum. So that's infrared light from contemporary 3D laser scanners and ultraviolet light used in one of the oldest photographic methods, the cyanotype. So these large-scale cyanotypes are sourced from 3D scanned point cloud data of living plants. And the project was a bit of an ode to Anna Atkins, who was the first female photographer to publish a book of plant studies as cyanotypes in 1843. Her work was actually often used by botanists to study plants, so I like that there's a nice interaction with art and science there. But while she produced her images by laying the plants flat on chemically coated paper, what I wanted to was more interested in exploring how our contemporary 3D data tool capture tools could allow me to portray these plants from multiple angles at the same time. So my process involves scanning the plants with a LiDAR scanner, which you see on the top right, and then collapsing their point cloud data models into flat compositions in these large scale negatives that are then exposed to sunlight and treated on the chemically treated paper and then developed by hand. So here I have two prints of a peace lily, and I make the negatives by navigating with the virtual camera inside of the point cloud models and then collapsing them onto multiple Photoshop layers in order to get one two-dimensional image. On the left here is a bamboo, and on the right are two perspectives of orchids. So they begin to kind of look like landscape portraits or something other than what the data suggests, which I love. And the prints are usually shown with this corresponding light installation as a rear projection on a suspended glass disc. And the piece is called the zero point field, which refers to the phenomenon in quantum mechanics, where they find that subatomic particle fluctuations are still measured even below absolute zero temperatures. So to me, when I found this out, it suggested that everything in our world on a subatomic level is in this kind of constant fluctuating exchange with everything else. So to evoke this, I use the point cloud scans of these plants slowly morphing in and out of each other in order to kind of offer a meditative experience to the viewer about our subatomic universe and its mysteries. It's a very slow piece, I'm not going to show you all of it, but the plants end up like, kind of morphing in and out of each other over time. This is another light installation, Inter Eye. It also considered the quantum fluctuations in the body. It was actually an ode to the death of a friend of mine who was taken by the Black Sea, which is often called the Sea of Death. And at the time I was really thinking about like where our essence goes after it leaves the body. I kind of kept imagining this body made of quantum electrons, photons and waves that are kind of all affected by the environment and forces in nature. And so the video that is played on this rear projection screen is actually produced by taking footage of the full moon reflecting on the Black Sea and then projecting that footage onto my own body from five different projectors as I kind of perform these series of movements. It's also very slow and meant to be kind of perceptually challenging and meditative for the viewer. And here I have a project that's a bit more technical. This is the first time that I worked directly with data. While I was researching memory in grad school, I wondered if I can create an internal portrait of the act of recalling a memory. So I built this custom software that logarithmically translated each brainwave band into its corresponding color harmonic frequency. And then I projected those color streams onto spherical blocks of ice. And this allowed me to produce these series of what I was calling brainwave portraits, or the act of recalling different dreams or different memories. So I would record my brainwave data while remembering things like petting a cat or watching the election or kissing someone, to kind of make these poetic images of what that might look like in color. And I was also really curious about the material aspects of memory and how the frozen water might be affected by the subtle energies in our bodies. So I started doing this sort of pseudoscientific experiment where I would ask friends to carry water near their bodies and sleep with it. And then I would freeze it and see if those structures would kind of change based on their vibrations. I was calling them frozen dream water portraits. And then ultimately this led me to work with the neurophysics lab at UCLA, where they study how memories and form not just in the brains of rats, but in their whole bodies. And to conduct their studies, they place rats in these virtual reality environments and have them running around on gyroscopes with electrodes inside of their hippocampus, where they measure how theta and... where they measure how how theta functions like a clock. So it's giving precise 10 millisecond waves to the gamma waves. And this correlation between the two is essential for memory synapses to form. So when I found this out, I was like, how fascinating that this deep unconscious theta wave requires the genius, so to say, of gamma wave. So I built this prototype that allowed me to stream my own real-time brainwave signals, orange for theta and purple for gamma. And I used them for a series of performances where I explored the question of, can my body illuminate a landscape with its internal signals? So what you're looking at on the right is me trying to, documentation of me trying to climb a tree with my eyes closed while this headband is streaming my brainwave activity. So every time it's yellow, I'm more prevalent in theta, and when it's purple, it's more prevalent in gamma. Of course, whether or not that's scientifically correct is questionable, but the process was kind of a poetic interpretation of what that might mean, how the body relates to the environment. I kind of get into gamma just a little bit there. Anyway, so a project that's more recent is Interbeing. That was the output of the residency I just did with the German Medical Imaging Center, Fraunhofer MEDIS, where over the course of a month, I worked really closely with scientists to locate the limits of medical imaging and machine perception. And during the residency, I became really drawn to these colorful images that you see on the bottom right, which are achieved with DTI scans or diffusion tensor imaging. This is an indirect measurement of nerve fibers and the flow of hydrogen along those nerve fibers. So they measure from 16 different directions to indirectly deduce where the nerves are. And they're usually only performed on the brain, so I really wanted to challenge this limitation and see if we can acquire data from different organs in the body to kind of produce a more holistic picture of the nervous system. So after a lot of convincing, I got the scientists to agree to scan my heart, my feet, and my reproductive organs. And ultimately it became a true collaboration because they had to actually come up with new MRI sequences to run the machines. And after more than 8 hours of being in the MRI machine, which was incredibly intense because I'm claustrophobic, I managed to acquire some really interesting data that I processed through a few different medical softwares in order to extract the nerve fibers around my organs and the 3D meshes. And conceptually in this process, I got really drawn by the hydrogen atom because I learned that despite it being foundational for the MRI process when measured in bulk, it's actually completely unpredictable on a nanoscale level. So on a quantum tempo, when these atoms are constantly binding and unbinding to other atoms. So this is the reason why scientists can't say for certain what percentage of water the body is composed of. So one nanosecond, they might measure it and it's 78% water, and the next it might be 89. So to me, this says that the closer we look inside of something, the more it kind of falls apart at the seams. And in the final work, I wanted to show these mysterious atoms popping in and out of existence to evoke the feeling that even the smallest particles in our bodies can affect our material experience. And here are the final organs of the vagina and ovaries on the left, the heart in the middle, and the feet on the right. And the final work was presented at Ars Electronica last year on these three 4K screens, a kind of triptych nod to the Holy Trinity, but in digital form. And I don't have time to show you the documentation, but I'm just going to play you these videos and hope that the streaming will be okay, just so you can get a sense of the feeling of them. It's only 1 minute long. So I also worked with a sound designer to calculate the mathematical sound of hydrogen into the auditory spectrum. So there are three different sounds composed in each video that kind of overlay with one another. And as you can see, I'm also bringing back a lot of the elements that get lost in the medical imaging, like the magnetic fields and the hydrogen atoms that are responsible for producing the images to begin with. So that's just a liberty that I can take as an artist, is to take the data and then make an affective experience that makes people feel something different. There's also a web AR component, which I developed that you can access yourself on intrabeing.com, where viewers can open up the nerve fibers as 3D models in augmented reality. And this AR component is a really important part of the work because it allows anybody to kind of have access to this data of the body and walk around it and have an affective experience in their own living room, essentially. And then finally, just to wrap up with my quarantine project, which was a print series and AR app that was done in collaboration with the environment, both invisible and invisible storms. And this project was shown at Little Bird Place and was curated by Rado and Teddy. It started with the experiment of taking frozen organic matter and exposing them to photosensitive black and white paper for the duration of local storms while I was locked at home for months at a time. This one, for example, was left outside for 12 hours in a rainstorm. They're a bit biographical in that I take elements that are around me at the time and see what happens with them. This one is made from pine needles of a dried Christmas tree. And then I scan and digitally alter the black and white paper to expose elements that are not visibly seen with our own eyes in the paper. So it's kind of a scientific experiment of my own to see how this can become a digital negative of a physically eroding process. Another one with needles and hand sanitizer left out for a week in a snowstorm. And the idea really was to kind of set these parameters for the structures and then I'll leave the rest of the composition to be resolved by the forces of nature. After I scan them, I reveal those elements and colors that aren't seen with their own eyes. And also at the time, I got to spend a lot of time with my grandma, who was an avid believer of geomagnetic storms and how they would affect her mood and sleep. So this kind of inspired me to start looking into what invisible storms might be doing to our bodies as we experience our lives on this planet. And I found ways to visualize them by accessing some real-time data from NOAA, as well as a connection with some scientists at Michigan State University who use supercomputers to map the magnetic field lines on the moon, on the sun, during super solar storms. So I used their field data in combination with the real-time wind data of NOAA to develop this augmented reality apps that display these changes in real time. So each print functions like an AR target, where an image tracker for this AR experience. And the apps are pulling real-time data from NOAA each day to visualize the changes of intensity in the magnetic lines. And the speed of the particles are also changing based on that data. So it's kind of an experience that takes over the viewer's personal space with the visualizations of planetary scale solar storms. Yeah, I have more projects to show you, but I think that's probably good enough for now.
Yes, Thank you. I can only say, wow.
Thanks.
You know, I'm lost in fascination, really. You made the science, all of you actually, now we'll see also Giuseppe, but it's extraordinary. And it is the winner of the European project BioArt Challenge organized by the Museum of Science Museum in Italy. And your research has started on scientific biology with the support of Cardiff University, Zurich University of Applied Science, and Trento, and the Museum of Science Museum. And you are also currently artist in residence at the microbiology lab of UCL University in London.
Yes. Hi. Hi, Carolina. Thank you, everybody.
Hello.
So I will start a presentation. Maybe I will also have something to share eventually. So thank you for the introduction. I'm Giuseppe Lo Schiavo, and I am an Italian visual artist based between London and Milan. My background is in architecture and visual design, and my practice is very much multidisciplinary. I use a variety of tools and technologies, from high-speed cameras, virtual reality, infrared systems, all the way to living microorganisms in the lab. And my research often focuses on opposing elements like creation, destruction, past, future, real, virtual. I discovered Figure 1A last year, thanks to a friend, Erika Fumagalli, which is also part of the team of the association. And for me, it was very interesting to actually discover their perspective of art, since they were mainly focusing on the scientific way to merge art and science. And I always had the opposite point of view from an artist approaching science. So that's very fascinating. I think, the artist should have just, you know, an ancillary role as entertainer in our society, but we can sit together on a table with scientists and also ask fundamental questions like what is life and what life can be. I think especially at this stage of this new bioart movement, especially in Europe, I think it's kind of new. And I'm very curious to see how the artists in the next decade can actually influence and expand the understanding of both disciplines as well. I will actually focus now, because we have just 10 minutes, on one specific project and what I'm working at the moment. So I started experimenting with bacteria cultures in my studio in London in 2018. And in 2019, I was offered an artist residency program for a year at the microbiology lab at the University College of London, UCL. So those are some of the pictures that I took in my studio in London before actually having a proper lab to work with. That actually was very unsafe to do, because I was working with pathogens and other bacteria that didn't know what they were, but it was also very interesting for me to store them in my fridge in my kitchen. So that's probably why they offered me the artist residency, because they didn't want to start a new pandemic. So I like to investigate the process by which anthropogenic modification altered the landscape. Like human activity has contributed to the alteration of the majority of Earth's surface. So this type of the rapid expansion and control over the planet has a striking similarity with bacteria contamination. Humans usually coalesce into dense population center, like bacteria colonies. And in order to have a more efficient social system, like we have in our cities. And when the conditions are right, they proliferate and leaving a mark on the surface, as much as we do with our cities, with the landscape in general. For instance, some of the Virgin Mary crying events in Europe, we had a lot in Italy as well, were actually attributed to the contamination of a special bacteria, which is the one that I actually discovered in the lab and I worked with. So I used a special bacteria called Serratia mercentis, which is an opportunistic pathogen that in specific condition produces a strong red pigment that is called prodigiosin. And the prodigiosin means extraordinary, miraculous. This pigment is being studied for its antibiotic and anti-cancer biological activities as well. So many historical events of Trastuban stamp station, this is a very difficult word to pronounce in English, which is the event in the Catholic Church when bread and wine used in the sacrament become the body and the blood of Christ, are being attributed actually to the contamination from this specific bacteria. In particular, like there was this episode in 1264 where a priest in Bolsena, Italy, was celebrating mass when the blood apparently appeared on the bread and of the communion and dripped onto the robe. This was actually the first time that the Serratia mercentis had directly influenced the arts, since the great master painter Raffaello also commemorated this apparent miracle in his La Messa di Bolsena, which is one of his masterpieces as well. So I used this bacteria to contaminate some printed photos taken by me in places where a process of alteration of the landscape is taking place. The prints are then sterilized and the trace of the red pigment remains on top of the paper. So altering the landscape of the image and leaving a mark of the bacterial contamination. There were no many really scientific papers actually to see how to use this bacteria for like artistic purposes. So I had to develop a new way to fix the color on the paper and to keep it bright as long as possible, because being a organic material, it's actually very delicate in terms of UV light and light fastness. So the extracted bacteria can also be used in the future, but actually it's being used actually now in study at the moment for the dye industry, especially because it is very environmental friendly since there are no chemicals involved in the extraction process and the pigment itself is not really toxic, and changing just the pH of the color, you can actually have a wider range of colors that you can access. And it's actually antibacterial, so it's actually, if you put it on some garments, you also have this kind of benefit, let's say. So those are some of the artwork. This is, for instance, how wide there could be the differentiation on the colors just by changing the pH of the production of the color from this bacteria. So at the moment, I'm working at this ICDC project, which is an European project in collaboration with the MUSE, the Museum of Science in Trento, where I'm starting a research. I started already a research on synthetic biology with the support of the Cardiff University, Zurich University of Applied Science, and University of Trento. So I'm trying to to go further into development of the new technologies like synthetic biology, artificial life, and crossing the boundaries between our understanding of what we consider a living or non-living entity. So with the help of the blockchain, I'm trying to create a digital entity, a digital art entity that can simulate the unpredictable and uncontrolled activities of living systems using as a canvas video of artificial cells that we are working on at the CBIO, which is the Cellular Computational Integrative Biology Department in Trento. And this is this is a new project that will be released probably, hopefully, before the end of the summer. So that's it. I think I will stop. If you have any questions, I'm here happy to go further and discuss more about the project.
Thank you. Thank you, Giuseppe. It was again, you know, again, fantastic for me that I am, you know, completely in the art world, but I didn't think how beautiful science would be translated into art. And through what I see today, it's extraordinary, really. Thank you. Thank you. Very, very. And as I said, Anna, you know, your figure one really translates to bring the audience, you know, to the public closer to science. So really your mission is accomplished. So no, because it's extraordinary. I think, you know, it's really opening up our also open art minded.
Yes. And it's interesting that the two, you know, you have science, you have art. And even though people start in one or the other, they come towards the middle. And things are very similar in that middle spot. It all looks like the universe to me, you know? Like infinity, and I think of all these things that the deeper you look, the further out you actually see, sort of.
That's deep.
So, but I love, you know, the fact that, you know, you can use, but now we are also, thank you, David. It is beautiful what you said, indeed. But we have George that is, you know, using also his way of painting in a way of mission for sustainability with the science.
It's very impressive how do artists trying to be involved with a scientist. It's a part of my practice as well as an artist. And especially this very critical era that we live, it's very important to have also results out of this collaboration, I mean, between art and scientists. And because I do the same, I mean, a part of my work also has the scientist part, I'm thinking of that there is a very specific a mission that we have to focus on. And there is also a very good and very crucial path to follow for us in order to make our work to be more specific and be more important for the humanity. Because we are a social, I mean, being artist is a social job, it's social work. And it's very interesting, the previous also project that, because it contains a lot of those informations, and we need this. And we need this to be presented in more important global-wise institutions like Biennale or stuff like that. We have to also introduce these kind of works also globally. And I believe now in the future, we're gonna have more chances for artists that they are collaborate with scientists to be presented. There is the future. For example, now I'm working for a program from Brussels, and I have to collaborate with a scientist too. And I see that there is a very interesting topics that we have to follow, because those topics are very special topics. It's not random topics, you know? And I'm thinking of that if we have also results, art doing a special work there. I don't know what to say about my work, but I'm actually working for the environment and new technologies and techniques, how to make them people to feel the sensitivity that we lack, making a special project with topics like the atmosphere, like the waters, like whatever, but basically focus on the our survivability into this planet. And I'm very happy for being in a conversation with artists like me, that we do the same. It's very nice and kind for you of giving us a voice and stick us, make us to be together. And thank we thank you.
Ευχαριστώ πάρα πολύ, George. Thank you. It's
I want to say that with Anna's talk, you know, it's amazing to see the members of Figure 1A. I've met some of them, and they're like so open-minded, and even though they're like really hardcore scientists, they're super interested in art, and they're like completely open to this journey of exploration, which is very important to have, you know, this mindset from both sides for a real project and a real adventure to take place. And then Silvia said something very curious. She said that scientists usually, they never publish negative results. But at the same time, it was these negative results which actually inspired her for some of her artworks. And I think this is a very curious field of potential collaboration between art and science, because with artists, I think are some of the freest people in the world, because for them, the free experimentation is something common, and I think most of them are not afraid of failure, or at least even if they fail, it's not like as if you fail in a scientific experiment and this might have certain consequences. I might be wrong, of course, with my perspective, but I definitely feel that this collaboration would open up this freer state of experimentation for the scientists themselves through the artistic means, through this artistic collaboration. So, and then Eli, one small aspect which I really liked is when she said that some of her works, they're scientifically inspired, and but not necessarily scientifically correct. And this is super curious, because this means that you have at least two levels of collaboration, one which is trying to be scientifically correct, but other which is opening up completely to the world, which is inspired by the science, but it lets it go, and it could go anywhere, you know? And these two are just two different aspects of this same potential, which I find interesting. And the last note about Giuseppe, you know, this graphic that you showed us with the bacteria and actually with the human contamination, with the human influence on the geographical landscape and the bacteria contamination, this is, I think, absolutely fundamental, because there is this scientific knowledge or saying which says that nature is self-similar across scale. So it's not by chance that on a micro level you have, you know, certain dynamics like a core and everything gravitating around the core, and in a very big scale like the universe, you have the same architecture. So that basically means that every process that we find on a micro level, we have the basis to explore it and try to imagine what is it, its replication on a larger level, related to our own lives, you know, related to social dynamics. And I think there's like a huge, huge, huge potential for development in this field as well. So these were my comments. I really wanted to share them because I find all of them to be very curious.
Thank you, Radoslav. I think, you know, you touched the most important threads through all these speakers, and I think that was very well said. Thank you. Just tell me what you want.